So welcome to Ruby Tuesday, JavaScript Penang number 6. And this meetup is proudly brought to you by Ruby Begins and also JavaScript Malaysia. You can join the links up here. And here's the Wi-Fi password for ACAT. And our sponsor, ACAT, for providing us the venue. I'm Hui, I'm the organizer of this meetup. So without further ado, let's start with blockchain with Ethereum and Solidity. So let's go. Okay.
So let me explain what is blockchain for you guys. Okay? So we're going to this website to see some visualized example for blockchain. So before we go into block and chain, we're going to explain what is hash. So this is SHA-256 hash. So every time you modify some data, every time you hash, the so-called your digital fingerprint here will be changed. So if you type nothing, you still can see this kind of this hash number. So everyone can understand what is hash. So then we go to block. Okay, this is called block. So block is kind of the data structure. So this is the block number. This is the data you contain inside. So every time you change the data, your hash will be different, right? So in order to make it as a valid block, you can see if you mine. So the hash we're looking for the front 4 0. In order, this is a valid block. Okay. So means that if I change the data here, the nonce will be find out the number that is valid for the front hash. The front 4 number will be 4 0. So after your mine, you can see that's nonce 72,608 for the nonce in order to get the front 4 number hash. In fact, 4 number 0 for the hash. So after we can explain the block, so we go to blockchain. Okay, this is called a blockchain. It's a kind of data structure similar to linked list that you got block number 1 until block number 5. Okay, block number 1 to block number 5 currently is the valid block. Okay, and that's okay. So you can see that the first block, the data structure inside will record the previous hash and current hash. So in order to know this, the block is linked, to understand is that the previous hash is the block number 2, previous hash is 1578. So you can see here it's 1578. So if I change something in the block 2, the hash number will be different from here. So it means that the block 3, 4, and 5 is currently the not valid block. Okay? So in order to get the valid block, you have to mine again. Mine this again, and mine this again. Okay, so if someone tried to modify block number 4, it will spoil the block number 5. So every time you want to write something into the new block, you have to write the data and then you remind again and put it into the block. So called blockchain. So you guys can understand what is blockchain now. Okay, so this is only one person for holding this data structure. So let's go to distributor. Okay, we got peer A, peer B, and peer C. So in order to know your block is genuine, so you will compare peer A, peer B, and peer C. So what if the peer B, they want to change some data in the block group? So peer B intend to change some data in the block group. It might again. So you will see the peer B, the previous hash and the peer B hash number is different from peer A block 2 hash number and peer C block number. So you can know that if someone tried to modify the data, you can know that the majority win. Means that if the majority are similar but are the same hash value, means that they are the true data. This is how the blockchain works. So, but in blockchain we don't, for the cryptocurrency we don't record this nonsense like HSS1, this data. So we do record all the transactions, like you can see that here. It's from A. I can't, it's the resolution problem. It means that A give to B person for how many months. So those, this is why blockchain can use that as a cryptocurrency trading. So it basically record all the transactions here. This is a very visualized intro to blockchain. Okay. So let's continue to the next slide. So what is Ethereum? So Ethereum is the kind of the first blockchain network that can deploy smart contract. So Ethereum is not only a transaction for the cryptocurrency, Ether is also used by application developer to pay for a transaction fee and services on the Ethereum network. So maybe I can briefly explain what this means. Okay, so this is like a visualize a slide to show how to interact with the Ethereum network. So this is an Ethereum network, not represented by different kind of people, maybe or different location of the data. So basically every node got the same database. So developer, they will use Web3 to interact with Web3.js to interact with the Ethereum node. So for consumer, they normally they will use some software, MetaMask or Mint browser to interact with the Ethereum network. So later I will show you the example of what is MetaMask. So just now we mentioned about smart contract. So in order to code with smart coding the smart contract, we use Solidity programming to program the smart contract. So Solidity is a type of programming language that got a static type programming compared to JavaScript is dynamic type. Means that you have to define the variable type. It's like integer, array, some kind of thing. So it's also similar to JavaScript, and also the founding will come out behind is .sol. It's a solid. So normally you will write some contract with Solidity programming language. So the Solidity compiler normally will compile into bytecode and the application binary interface. So the bytecode concept is like similar to Java. So normally the Java will compile the bytecode. So the bytecode in order to run in the Java version. Same to the Ethereum. Solidity will compile, Solidity compiler will compile the Solidity code to byte code in order to run in Ethereum virtual machine. And also, it will also compile the application binary interface to use its interact with the binary, the bytecode, to interact with the bytecode. So the Solidity, so normally the JavaScript code will through this application binary interface to interact with the bytecode. Okay, this is a Solidity compiler. In order to, we can use this compiler to interact with the Ethereum network. So later I will give you some guys an example for this. Okay, so okay, let's go to gas and transaction. So you guys can see this is a gas. So basically, it's like you write some smart contract into the Ethereum network, and then you let Ethereum to run this kind of work. So basically, the blockchain in the Ethereum is helping you to run the application logic. So every time, so if you deploy this contract to the Ethereum network, people will try to run the code. So if the guy runs the code, you have to pay him some money. So this is all gas. The gas is used for pay for those mining people to run the application project. So you can see that this is the gas cost for every transaction. So let me give some example. Okay, let's say I got the means that. This is an example. This is the example that we're doing some transaction. It's a code that it's like when you want to execute those add or subtract or divided, you have to pay some money. So called gas. So this is the example. The so-called do math function. You can see here, do math function. So what do math function is do is that add, subtract, multiply, and equal. So every time you execute this add operation, it will cost 3 gas. So you can see that you can limit every transaction 10 gas price, but you can give this transaction gas price and gas limit. So last example is that if you set the gas limit 10, you only can run these 2. Means that the total needed gas is 14, but you only gas limit must be 10. So you only can run add and subtract. So the Ethereum network won't run multiply and equalize. So basically this is the gas transaction. So you can see that here, the Ethereum got different unit conversion. So maybe 1 Ether is equal to those like 0.01001 candle. So this is just the different unit. So if you can see 1 Ether is equal to $211 kind of thing. This is just basically the unit conversion. So another thing we will mention about mnemonic phrase. So what is mnemonic phrase? You can see here, later we will explain what is mnemonic phrase. It's like mnemonic phrase is a kind of the words to record your public key, private key, and address. So you can't remember this kind of long hexadecimal code. So you try to, so they will give you some algorithm called BIP39 to convert this phrase into the public imperative. And give you some example. So this is my mnemonic phrase. I don't mind the writer. So we'll go to this website to see how it works. So this is called the BIP mnemonic code converter. basically I just paste my memory. Sorry. So I should pay this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 12 phrase into here. So you can convert to those address. So this is my address, my public key and private key. So be careful to store this word. I mean, every time you want to create a new account, definitely they will give you this. Create this mnemonic phrase to get the public and private key. So be careful to store this phrase. Okay. So let's continue. So I'm going to show you. I will deploy my first contract to the Ethereum network. So basically, we'll need some tools, which is the Remix Solidity Compiler. And if you guys are interested, you can clone from my GitHub the project. And also, we'll get some Ether, the money to. Yeah, I think I forgot to mention about this. So in order to run those function, you need money. That's why the money comes from the Ether. So every time when you execute the code here, you have to need some Ethereum money, the Ethereum coin. So you can see here. Okay. So we'll get some Ether and also install some numbers. So let's go into deploy our first contract. Okay. So I'm going to show you the code, what I'm doing for the contract. So basically, this is the Solidity inbox code. Means that the inbox can store the message. So this is public and access. From here. So this is the constructor. So we got the two functions here, which is the set message and the get message. This is the constructor when you initially create this inbox code to store the initial message, and then also this is a function, it's called set message to set a new message to the issue. So okay, this is the song. So let's go to the file, which is the compile and deploy. So just now I have mentioned about we need some field library, which is the Solidity compiler and the file system. Because of Solidity is written in different language, it's not JavaScript. So we need some file system and path in order to read the inbox Solidity contract. So okay. So basically, this is just a program to read the inbox Solidity contract. So let's go to deploy.js. Okay, you can see that we need few library, which is the HD wallet provider, Web3, and the provider. I will explain to you what is HD wallet provider. Basically, HD wallet provider is kind of the library to let you to put your mnemonic code at the provider in order to create a provider for Web3. So the HD wallet provider, you can see here, the HD wallet provider contains two arguments, which is your mnemonic and the provider, the okay. This is the provider and the point to connect to the Ethereum network. So if the second argument here, you can create your own Ethereum network in your computer, but you have to download the so-called the initial download block about almost one terabyte for the main network. But currently we're using the Ring Kirby test network, so that it not be so many. But also this, I didn't run any Ethereum blockchain in my computer, so that's why I'm using the Infura. So Infura is a API to let us, we use their API to access to their feature network. So we don't create our own feature network. Because it might take some time to also set up and also to download the block data. Means that everyone got the same block data, we have to download the block data and synchronize. So okay, let me explain to you what's Web3. So Web3 is a JavaScript library to interact with your Ethereum network. So in order to use your Web3 library, you have to provide some provider to the Web3. So you can see that what my provider inside of my morning code and the place I want to connect to my connect to the Infura recovery test network. So we got few test networks and we got few networks I can bring to you later. So you can see that the Web3 is required a provider in order to use this for Web3. Okay, let's go to the deploy function. So this is a deploy asynchronous deploy function to do is that the Web3 will get my first account to deploy to my first you can see this is my first account. Okay, so what I deploy to my first contract is that the argument I put is the height that this is the first time I deploy the first Ethereum contract. So you can change the content here. You can change the content to Ruby, Love, Ruby and JavaScript in a message. So after I run this deploy.js, so basically I will write this message into the Ethereum network. So it means later we will get access by the Ethereum address. So let's run this code. So basically just deploy.js. So wait a moment for writing the connect to the provider network app. So this is the account I use to deploy the Ethereum contract. So wait a moment to get the address back. Take some time to get out. Okay. Now we get the contract address. So this is the contract address to interact with your, just now I can say it's the inbox solidity contract. So in order to interact with this contract, we have to use some Ethereum compiler here. So if you go remix.ethereum.org, we can get the solidity compiler here. So what we are going to do now is that we will run our account with the MetaMask. Okay, let me briefly explain what is MetaMask for this. So MetaMask is kind of the client application for you to manage different account. Means that you can have multiple accounts here to manage your Ethereum wallet. So currently my current account got 37 Ether. You can get it on the Recovery official website to get the Ether to run some tests. So one thing I want to mention is that once you deploy the contract into the network, to the network, it can't be changed. So you can see the MetaMask provided few different network here. So we got currently using Recovery. So this is the main Ethereum network. So if you deploy the contract to the main Ethereum network, means that you can't change. So every time you want to design, you have to design the smart contract properly. Okay. So you also can test in your local host network or some customer RPC. So basically, this is what MetaMask for. So currently, my remix already connect my MetaMask Web3 MetaMask environment. So this is my account, you can see here. This is my public address, which is same with my public address here. Yeah. Same with my public address here. So it's EAE3. So EAE3. Okay. So just now I showed you guys that I already deployed the contract to the ring curve test network. Yeah, I copy the address node after. Sorry, I have to deploy it. So let's run the deployment. So I re-upload the contract to the ring curve test network. So you can see I'm using my account EAE3 to deploy the contract. So which means it will spend my Ethereum wallet money to the ring curve test network. So every time you run the code, you deploy the code, you have to pay some money to deploy it. Pay some money, which is a fake money. So after I get the address, okay, so I just paste my address here to get my contract. So you can see the contract now is here. So when I get the message that I first initially deployed, you can see that Ruby and JavaScript here. What I modified my code here. So because I got to write a solidity function, it's called set message, which means that you can actually deploy a new message in order to replace this string. So I can write hello in order to replace this. So I set message again. So my MetaMask will go. So my MetaMask will inform me to make some confirmation for this operation. Because of sending a new message, you have to you need some money. So my MetaMask is money. Got some network problem. So it basically just got some problem with the MetaMask. But basically, if I set a new message here, when I confirm with MetaMask, then I should be able to modify the variable here in the Ethereum blockchain, in the ring curve test network. So, by the way, if you have some doubt with the block, you also can go to some website called ringcurve.etherscan to check your transaction. So basically, you just paste the address to check the transaction. So you can see the block is just put into the blockchain 2 minutes ago, and it's from which account, also what's the transaction fee and the value of the token. So basically, we already successfully deployed our host contract. So if you guys have any question about it?
So when you modify the message, will it be a new new transaction added to the blockchain, or just trigger the same contract?
Okay, so if you let's say this is the set message function. If you try to set a new message again, basically you just you don't need to redeploy your contract. The contract already there. What you modify is the variable inside this. So you can see string public message. This is what we try to modify the variable. So that basically this is the function to modify the public variable, not really deploy anymore.
So when you change, you add a new set message, it's basically a new transaction type to the blockchain, or you just trigger the, because I don't understand when you tie the new block.
Basically every transaction, like just now I mentioned about I deploy the contract, right? Basically when I deploy the contract and then I set message again, it basically it's the two transactions.
Or
once the time you deploy the contract, you already write to the blockchain.
Yep.
So in order to modify the message again, it's another block. So basically this is it.
Okay. So when you do a set message, you'll get a new address, right? The new address for your
The address is still same. The contract, the address is just the address to interact with the contract.
Okay.
So it's similar to your backend.
Uh-huh.
Let's say you build a Node.js backend or Ruby. Uh-huh. So basically it's like you've got a static IP address.
Yep.
But in blockchain network we don't have the IP. So it's just basically the address to interact with
the contract.
It basically is just your business logic, all your logic is there.
The transaction hash will change because it's a new transaction.
Yeah, the transaction is still, if you get the message from the variable, it doesn't cost the money. Like, when I get the message, it doesn't cost the money. What if you set the message inside the, you try to modify the data, you have to pay some gas for the transaction. So normally this is how it will work.
So, is there any way to destroy this contract?
No.
Once you write it?
Once you write it, you can't destroy it. Because of, you remember, everyone hold one copy of the blockchain. So it means that if you want to destroy, you have to destroy everyone. Blockchain. Also, if you, like I mentioned just now, the example.
Because you need to close the contract, right? Some. You have one contract one, and then 1 month later, you want to publish another contract, close the contract one.
You can't close it. Yeah, it's like what I mentioned about the block.
Uh-huh.
So if you try to modify this block,
the subsequent
block will also be affected. So it's quite hard if you can remind yourself, you can mind again, but you can see that let's say I gave you an example like that. I do this, I mine again, but you can see the hash value from the peer B and the peer C is different. Means that you are the fake one.
Yep.
So you can go to some example, so called the Byzantine for orange number. In order to know the trader, I mean, if the trader is, let's say, for example, you got five people. If you got more than two traders, means that your network is can't be trusted again. This is basically how blockchain works.
So if someone deploy a mistake in the contract up,
yeah,
then how do you
fix it?
Okay.
And then
new contract. You cannot use the old address already.
Yeah, you can't use.
So it'll stay there forever.
Yeah, stay there forever. Because of if you deploy the wrong contract, then maybe you have to call people to change the address.
Because if someone deploy a contract saying that pay to address, so if the mistake contract is up there, everyone just keep on send me money, you put your address, then you cannot close it anymore.
Yeah,
so the contract will always there.
This is because of this is happened to the Ethereum classic. That's why they fork the new Ethereum. That's why the current, so you can see the current, and also why my MetaMask is on.
Let's say if I do agree on the contract, I'll pay $1,000 for doing this.
Okay.
And then you are the one who develops my contract, you will have a new contract saying that you will pay me 3000 ringgit within this. Then should I submit? No. Because you can't just upload a new contract and erase the old contract. The old contract must be there because someone is still using it.
Yeah. So that's why every time you want to design a contract, you have to design properly. Also test in test network. So don't so fast to deploy into the main network. I'm not sure why I'm my data master. So you can. So because of got few test network, you can be the robster. You can test whatever you can, and then make sure everything's okay. Then only you deploy to the main network. Yeah. So you can test whatever how many times you want in the. The test network. So basically, you can see that the I give one more example, maybe some ERC20. So you want to create a coin. So this is the ERC is means that it's the Ethereum standard for creating a coin. So basically, you can get the Ethereum source code, the smart contract source code for creating the token. Let's say this is the. So you just copy all the code and then you try to modify the server. Basically, it's like create your own cryptocurrency based on each unit.
Mm-hmm.
So this is
okay.
All my cryptocurrency. Any question you want to ask?
Okay. Thank you very much. Four. Hey. Okay. Thank you, Sanker, for introducing us to Ethereum. So, next one.
Next talk will be on.
Extend Java application with JRuby. So let's get started. JRuby. So JRuby is a Ruby language written in called JVM, Java. So it runs in JVM. For Ruby, we have multiple variants. We have JRuby, we have MRI, CRuby. So today we'll be talking about running Ruby in JVM. So why JRuby? Because it's able to run inside JVM virtual machines and also fast and true multi-thread. So for like Python or Ruby, it's a different language, so they have a guild lock, so it doesn't really run multi-thread. You can run it, but you need to manage it. If you run in a JVM, it runs multi-thread automatically. So JVM manages multi-thread for you. And why not just write Java? Because if you write Ruby, you know that Ruby is easy to write, and then you get the performance from Java into Ruby. And also, it's platform agnostic, so it means you can work with Ruby in any OS. So you can install in Windows, which is quite hard if you want to install Ruby in Windows. So how to install? First, you need to install Java so that you get the JVM, and then you install JRuby with this link. So let's get started. The code So disclaimer, I only play with JRuby for a couple of weeks, so not professional and doesn't deploy production code for JRuby. How to import Java package. So you might write multiple classes, multiple files for Java project, and then you put it into a package. So to import all those packages into JRuby, you just need to do include package. And then create a module. Using that module is basically calling the Java package. So let's run this. It will say that okay, this is a warning saying that now they doesn't use Java lang string only, directly use Java string. But it's the same thing, you will get a Java object created in the JRuby files. So you can use Java directly in JRuby. How to use jar files? So in Java, you can compile your Java code into jar or var. Var is for web, jar is for Java compress package. So to do that, we have a simplified class, a simplified script to use. So we will require for Maven. So what require for Maven does is it's grabbing the library from the Maven path. So normally the Maven path is home directory, m2, and repository. So we can go and check the So these are all the libraries used by Maven. If you have a Maven project, you will have all this library in this folder. So to prove that, it's better for you to write a script so that you won't be writing all this over and over again. And then you just need to pass it to group, the artifact, the version. Right? So let's go back. And then to get the jar library, you just call the function from the script. Require for Maven, then your group, package your version. So from here, we are calling a login, a Java log logging library to use in Ruby. So you can see it's using the format of log4j. So you can see here is the library log factory. We are calling log factory directly using this command, this code. So org.apache.com is our login. Because we already import the library, you can directly call this and then assign to a variable called Java log factory. And then Java log factory is the same as you calling a Java API. So you can refer to the log factory API. How you will do if you want to import a library from Java even. Go to extend Java class in Ruby. So let's say you will have a class written in Java and then you want to use it for your JRuby. So how do you do it? You can actually extend it with first we import the class. The class, this is the package. So TK is a TK folder, and we extract MY and this abstract class element. This is the Java code. So it's an abstract class. Just say hello. How many times you want to say hello? And then, there's no implementation of hello. So when you extend it, you're able to define what is hello. So this is actually, if you have some implementation already done to Java, you want to continue JRuby, you can by extending. Then override the hello functions, then puts hello, then you can directly call it. So Ruby element new.sayHello. Here doesn't have say hello. Say hello is actually from here. So say hello is in Java class. So this is how you can actually call that function from a JRuby. Thanks. So you see 5 lines because it says 5. So what this does is it creates a new Ruby element object because it's a class, create it and then call a say hello function which is from the Java class. So you can see Java and puts hello. So print out hello 5 times. So this means that you can merge Java and Ruby in use it combine and interchangeably because both works really well. It's good for debugging. So in JRuby, you can debug your code by using a Ruby debug. So you can run this code. Or So to run debug, you need to pass in a flag for debug. If not, it won't allow you to go into a debug. So now you're in debug mode. So these are the available commands that you can use. Debug mode is not directly UV. So I haven't really explored this debug mode, but this is how you can actually go into the HeroD debugger. It's different from Cry. Cry is the MRI debugging for Ruby, C Ruby. So this is the Java version. So it looks a bit different. Where it tells you where, which line currently you are in right now. You can trigger IRB in here also, so that it can go into a JRuby interactive console, so you can add your Ruby code here. It works. Sure, whether it passes. Yeah, it actually passes the code. So whatever you have is passing it to the IRB. So you can do some data testing and verification here. That's it. That's it for the debugger. Next one we'll go for compiling. So how do you compile Hello World? So Hello World Java is actually having a Ruby code inside. So when you write Java code, you can embed your Ruby code inside your Java code. So you can see two language can compile and it works. So you can mix and match. You can load a Java class while inside you run a Ruby script. So how to do that? So this is the same. You can actually use now can use Java to power. You pass in the JRuby jar. So that's a JRuby complete library. You can download from JRuby website. It's a complete binary containing all the Ruby syntax. And then you compile the Go Java. So let's try this. So this string is coming from this is running Ruby, so this is coming from there, and then this is the class that's being compiled from JRuby. So you can use Java P. Now you know that how to insert the Ruby code inside Java, right? How about compile Ruby code into Java? So you can see here we are converting Ruby code into Java code. So let's see, this is over Ruby. So first we require Java. So in JRuby, you require Java just so that you can use Java objects. Then you create a class with a Java signature for a main string. So in Java class, you will start with main, right? A main method. So this is how you start with the main method. You link that signature to the Java signature, saying that, okay, this is actually the void main. And then you pass in an argument. So call the class sample, right? So if you look at code, you use JRubyC. JRubyC is a JRuby compiler. And then how you want to use it, there's two options. You can use it Java or JavaC. JavaC is it compiles into a class. If you use Java, it just compiles from Java file. Right? So we can see the code of this. We can run this code. So I'm running Ruby compile, and then you can see sample class and sample Java. So what is inside sample Java? So this, all this code are generated by the JRuby compiler. You can see it created a public class sample extends to the project. And then it also have a source string builder. This is the Ruby code that we have now. Then the constructor, Ruby object, all this stuff. And then you see iRuby objects. So all these are all from the jruby.jar file. So you can see all rg.jruby Ruby. All these are getting from the library. So how do you use it? See here. You need to link the jruby jar so that the sample Java knows where it holds syntax from. So you can run it. Since we already compiled it, let's try to run this one. Hello world from JRuby. So it's exactly the same as the one we write here. Hello world from JRuby. So this is how to able to compile the Ruby code into Java class or Java file and then compile again to JVMY code. So I write Ruby but deploy to Java. That's the secret how to do that. So the last one is Wobble. So what is Wobble? Wobble is a tool in JRuby where you can compile your JRuby, all your JRuby folders code into one package and deploy as Java. So how to do that? First, you need to have a gem file. So this is how to create a gem. Normally in CRuby, you can create a library using a gem file and a gem spec. So a gem file to install Wobble. Then for gem spec, you can define what is this library for. Because a jar basically is like a Java library. So you define in Ruby, it's almost the same. You write the summary, you write the version, you write the files, executable, main. Then in main, this is your main class. When it starts compiling, it will find this file first. Where this is the first file, the Wobble will hit. And then the functions, and then the library here. This is the library for your gem, or we now call it Java library because we're compiled with Java. So you can write some classes and write a module that stores the variables, and also a class inside the module to print out the variables. So you can do this multiple class in Ruby, but in the end you can deploy as a Java jar. How to do this? This is how we'll be doing this. First we want Wobble compile jar. We run Wobble. Okay, first we bundle install Wubble. be the wobbler for me because I get from the latest. Yeah, I get from the latest wobbler. Because I saw their build is failing. Maybe it's infecting. Let's do something different. Get it from the official one. Don't get it again. Shoot that over. If not, then we won't be demoing this part. There's something went wrong. It was previously, now it was over. Blogging for Java, blogging game, stuff you can consider. Nothing else different, I guess. Yeah. So, let's see. Yes. Okay. Something went wrong. Now it's working. Luckily it's working. So we can run this bubble bug, yeah. So when we compile, you can see it's doing something here. It's referring to class path. Compiling, it's creating this jar, then removing the main class here and subclass here. So from here you can see, okay, it's created the jar. So how to run the jar? Because we did have some executable for the main, right? So just now we have main, and here saying that it will print out something. We run that library. So let's run the library. So here you can see that, okay, it's print out jar example and some class bar, which is exactly here. My bar is actually also. And then some my class bar is. So it actually do what it's supposed to do in JRuby. It's written in Ruby, but running using Java. So that's how you can use Java JVM to run Ruby and Ruby to run Java. So both ways work. You can both do whatever you want in both ways. So Ruby and Java is possible. And we will have a lot of fun. Doing this because you know, find a lot of issues like just now the wobble. So that's conclude the demo. So who is using? Gojek is using. So one of the largest company in Asia is using JRuby, running in production. Puppet is using JRuby. So if you know the provision tools. It's using JRuby. Blockstash is using JRuby. So the one that consume a lot of logs and modify and process logs is using JRuby also. Because they like the performance of JVM but the simplicity of Ruby. So all these are the references that you can refer to if you want to try out JRuby. Any questions about JRuby? Yeah, you can. Yes. Yes, as jar, and then you can include it to the Java project because you don't have to deal with Ruby. You just want it to be a library, and then you just call it library. So you can have both Ruby team and Java team working on the same project. Very interesting concept. Performance wise, there's also a very good comparison to run C Ruby versus J Ruby. There's a performance improvement also. Because it's having the agility of Ruby and the multi-threading performance of JVM. So when Java is improving, Ruby also improves. So you see the improvement is exponential. Rather than like Ruby is just normal line and then Java is normal line. Because you're mixing to get together, it's exponential. Your JVM improved, you also improve. Ruby improved, you also improve. So it's like exponential. Okay. More questions. Any questions we go for? 5 tech tips. Any tips that you can give? Any tips? So Ruby serverless. Recently, Amazon already have Lambda support Ruby. So previously we have JavaScript, then we have Python, then now we have Ruby. Finally, we have Ruby support in AWS Lambda. Because if run Ruby serverless, it's basically like Sinatra. It's like Python plus. It's just a big function you throw into the serverless and you can run. So finally, we're supporting it. Azure is not. The cloud is not also. So this is the first one to support that. Okay. And more. What JavaScript? Tips about JavaScript. Any tools that you use? Another one is for Ruby. There's a website called awesomeruby.com. You can see all the projects related to Ruby, including ETL, processing, data concurrency, networking, data visualization, e-commerce and payments, down to wherever you can think of. QR, robotics. So do check it out if you want to know more about the libraries and also the frameworks around Ruby. JavaScript debugging tips. For state of 2018. So until now, our meetups have six meetups starting from July. We cover 2 venues. So we've been to ACAD here, we've been to settlement. So attendance for 2018. For first meetup we have 10. Then second we have 9. It's the same as September, October. So our average is around 5. Which is okay for the beginning because we consistently hit every month, which is a good thing. We didn't stop posting every month. We will have one, and then our meetup topic coverage is JavaScript is 42 42%. Ruby topic is 58%. So we'll see more topics coming up next year. So thank you for all the attendance that comes to the Meetup for 2018. And then speaker for the Meetup, I got one slot for Zing. Because I did ask him if he agreed for January. Anyone wants to go for January? Anyone? And February I have one more speaker also. So, shout out Harry. Any Harry? No shout outs, no shout out, no events. Okay, so thank you for being here and see you next year. Okay, thank you, thank you. I think I have all your names already, right? Remember.
So later I fill up the